So, good morning, folks at home. This is the last new material we're covering before your final exam. And question on final exam is, if you didn't miss any days, which means you turned in all your material on time if you're a home school student, all those attendance quizzes and so forth, if you didn't do those on time, I consider that absent, and you need to take the final. If you miss less than 2 days, you can take your class average, and that's as of the end of the semester, so we've got more stuff that I haven't recorded that will probably go on there as well, so it could be good or bad. I have a few things people have submitted late that hasn't been graded. Greatest common factor. So let's look at this. Greatest common factor, what we are looking for there, and I will show you a shortcut here, is we want to look at the coefficient of the variable, and then we want to look at the variables. And we're looking at each individual term, so each monomial here, and we're factoring out something that is common in both monomials so that we have a simpler binomial there. And so looking at the first one, Matthew, what do you think is the greatest common number for both? Okay, well, 12 and 10, what goes into both 12 and 10?
Two.
Very good. So, but if you didn't know that value, okay, let me show you a quick shortcut here, is if you don't know the number that goes into both, you can type the number in as a fraction, so 10 divided by 12 or 12 divided by 10, either one works, okay? Which phone line? And hit math, enter, and you will see it reduces that fraction to 5/6. So 5/6 means that I divided 10 by some value that was common and got 5, and I divided 12 by some value that's common and I got 6. So if you just say 10 divided by 5, my greatest common factor has to be 2. Okay? Then we have a cubed and a squared. If you think of a cubed as a times a, and you think of a cubed as a times a times a, we want to know what's common in both. So we have, let me see here, 2 times 3 times 2, and a times a times a. If I break both of these down into their prime factorization, 2 times 5, and that's a 2, not a z, and then a times a. We want what is common in both. So we have a 2 that's common in both, and we have AA is common in both. So 2A squared is my greatest common factor. And then the other factor is what's left over. 2 times 3 is 6. And just 1A, same sign here. We had 5 left over here. So this is the factorization of that term. So 2 a squared times 6a plus 5. Sorry about that. I almost wrote b down for some reason. I don't know why. That's 6a plus 5. The next one. You guys try the next one on your own and see if you can come up with the correct solution. I'll give you just a minute to try that. I zoomed in just a little bit. I think I'm still recording, but hopefully you can see a little better. Let's look at this term. Okay. So I have 7 and 14 for my numbers. So 7 is common for both. And I look at my variables. I've got m to the 8th and m squared. The easy way to do this is m times m. This is m written out 8 times. So the thing that's going to be common is the smaller of the two exponents. So I'm going to say m squared. Same thing with the n, the smaller of the 2 and 5, since n is in both terms. And that's n squared. And then I ask myself, what would I multiply times 2m squared n squared to get this first term? Because this is like undistributing the values. When you're factoring, it's undistributing, basically. So 7 would have to be multiplied by 2 to get 14. M squared would have to be multiplied by m to the 6th to get m to the 8th, because we add exponents here, right? And n squared times n to the 3rd power would give me n to the 5th. 2 plus 3 equals 5. You can think of this as 5 minus 2 gives you 3 as well. That helps you a little bit. The middle term here is minus, and 7 times 1 is 7, so we don't have to even write the 1, except for the fact that 7m squared n squared is our term, and if we don't put a 1 as a placeholder here, if I distribute this, I would only get the first term, not the two terms. So make sure when you finish that if you go backwards, you will end up with the correct result. Okay? Perfect squares. Okay? Now, perfect squares, we had a formula for. But let's go back and review a little bit what perfect square numbers are. Perfect square variables are pretty easy. A to the second power is a perfect square variable, but let's look back at our constants. Think of some perfect squares. So 1 squared is just 1, 2 squared is 4, 3 squared is 9, 4 squared is 16, 5 squared is 25, 6 squared is 36, 7 squared is 49, 8 squared is 64, 9 squared is 81, 10 squared is 100, we could go on and on, okay? I'm going to stop there. And what our rule is, if we have the difference of two squares, so the first term is a perfect square, and the second term is a perfect square, they're separated by a minus sign, that's where we get difference of square from, as a definition. But my difference of square values, if I have an a squared minus b squared term, when I factor that, I'm going to end up with a different color. I'm going to end up with an a minus b times an a plus b. My middle terms, my a times positive b is ab, and negative b times a is minus ab. Those middle terms, when you FOIL, will cancel out, and that's why we know immediately when we see a term like this that we're going to factor it in this way. So remember, you can use this note packet or handwritten notes, whatever you have, on the final, which is next Thursday. So you should take good notes here. Let's look. Is 9x squared a perfect square term? Let's check. What is the square root of 9? That's 3. What is the square root of x squared? It's x. Okay, so that works. 49 has a square root of 7. Y squared has a square root of y. So my first one is going to be 7x plus y, or the order doesn't matter. You can go 7x minus y, or I'm sorry, I apologize. 3x minus 7y and 3x plus 7y. Okay? That gives us our difference of squares factors. Pretty simple? Great. Let's move on. 72c to the 4th minus 2. Well, first of all, 72 is not a perfect square. C to the 4th is, and 2 is not a perfect square. So, can we use the formula here? Not as is, but remember the first thing we did up here, greatest common factors. We may have a greatest common factor here that if we factor that out, we'll be left with the difference of squares. Let's try. If I have 2 and 72, if you type that in the calculator, 2 divided by 72, math, enter, you'll get 1 over 36, which means that the number 2 is common in both. So I have 2 times 36, c to the 4th power, minus 1. 2 times negative 1 gives me minus 2 here. Make sure you account for that placeholder. Now this is the difference of perfect squares. I'm going to have the square root of 36. We keep the 2. The square root of 36, though, is 6. The square root of c to the 4th is c squared. The square root of 1 is 1. So I know my values here are 6c squared and 1. One of them is positive. One of them is negative. To make my center terms cancel out. Pretty easy stuff if you think about it broken down. Let's try number 5. Number 5. I see a 7 and a 28. Can anybody tell me, is there a common value there? 7. Great. Okay. M to the 7th and M. You use the smaller exponent, which is just M to the 1st power. N and N cubed would be just N. Whoops. Just N. Okay, so 7mn here times 1m to the 6th power. This 1 plus 6 has to add up to 7. And then n times n squared would be in my second term. I have a minus sign here. 7 times 4 is 28. M times 1 is M, so we don't have a M value in that second term. So let me write that a little neater. 7mn times, this is a perfect square. I'm going to go ahead and factor that, m to the 3rd. What is that? N to the 4th? Oh, I'm sorry. Just minus 4n squared. So the square root of 4n squared is going to be 2n. So I have that, those values twice, m cubed here and 2n here. 1 is going to be plus, and 1 is going to be minus. Any questions? Tnw is common here. You guys, try and factor that one on your own real quick. Please tell me I'm still recording. I am still recording. Hopefully you got it. If you factor out the 10W, that leaves us with W to the 4th minus 1. You have to keep the 1 as a placeholder. Remember, if you distribute this, you have to come up with this term. So 10W times W to the 4th is 10W to the 5th. 10W times negative 1 gives us minus 10W. If you don't put the 1, you don't end up with that minus 10W. So this is perfect square, perfect square. Square root of W to the 4th is W squared. Square root of 1 is 1. So W squared plus 1, W squared minus 1. Perfect cubes, sum of cubes. So the first term has a cube root, and the second term has a cube root, and they are added together. We actually have the sum of cubes and the difference of cubes. We do not have the sum of perfect squares. So that one isn't factorable using this term. Only the sum and difference here, okay? Let's think about what perfect cubes are. That's not one that we use a whole lot. So you guys probably aren't as familiar, but go through and think about it. What are perfect cubes? 1 times 1 times 1, 1 cube, is just 1. Then the next term would be 2 cubed. 2 times 2 times 2 is 8. 3 times 3 times 3 is 27. 4 cubed is 64. Apologize. Then 5 cubed is 125. 6 cubed, I think it's 216. Yep, 216. And 7 cubed, 343. 8 cubed, 512, and of course that goes on and on and on. We don't need to list them all, we just try to look for that value. If you're unsure, it's real easy to take the cube root of something in your calculator. You just hit math, come down here, number 4 is cube root. Number 5, you can take the x root of something. So if you want the 4th root, 5th root, or even cube root, you just type that value in there as your index. And if you wanted to know if 999 has a cube root, bam, it does not. Okay? It's very close to a number that does, which is 1,000. So you can check a number, and remember, you may want to factor out another number if you have a term that doesn't have a cube root. So let's take a look here. Our rule for the sum of cubes, if I have a to the third plus b to the third, the sum of two perfect cubes, then I am going to say that is factorable by the cube root of both. So A plus B will factor out, and what I have left is going to be A squared minus AB plus the second term here, B squared. So it's not as complicated as it looks, but you can use your notes here. Take a look at it here. We have the cube root of A cubed is A. Cube root of B cubed is B. This first term is plus. Then we have a trinomial. A times A squared gives me A to the third. So this first term squared goes here. The 2 multiplied times one another goes here, but we subtract it. So A times B is AB. The last term is just this second term here, squared, B squared. Hopefully everybody sees the pattern. Just plug those values in and this works pretty easily. The cube root of x cubed is x. The cube root of 27 is 3. So I have x and 3 as the cube root of those two terms. Then I multiply it by this first term squared. Then subtract the product of these two. So subtract 3x. And then we add the last term, which is 3 squared. 3 squared is equal to 9. Any questions? Let's try the next one. There is a cube root of m to the third power. Cube root of 216 is on our list here. That's 6. Cube root of n cubed is n. So, my first term, m plus 6n, it's the cube root of this plus the cube root of that. Then I multiply that by this first term squared. Multiply the two together, subtract that. So 6n times m is 6mn. And then the last term squared, we're going to add, and 6 squared is 36, n squared is just n squared. Process pretty easy to follow. Okay. So, here we want to look and see if 500 is not on our list here. We have a 512, so that doesn't work. Let's think, is there a value that will go into both of these terms, the greatest common factor? If we typed 4 divided by 500 into my calculator and hit math, enter, enter, I see yes, a number is common for both, and it's going to be 1 times 4 would give me 4, and 125 times 4 gives me 500. So 4 is common. It's 125 times 4. And 1 times 4. If you factor that out. So this is a perfect cube. This is a perfect cube. We have to keep the 4. But we take the cube root of 125, which is 5. The cube root of a to the third power is a. That's my first value. The cube root of 1 is just 1. 1 times 1 times 1 is 1. The second value here, I'm going to take this term and square it. 5 squared is 25. A squared is just a squared. Multiply the two together. Subtract that, minus 5a. Square the last term is plus 1. There's my factors. Not terribly complicated. Next, let's think, same process. 24 and 375. If I take 24 divided by 375, math, enter, enter, I get 8 over 125. So 8 times what value gives me 24? 125 times what value gives me 375? I can see pretty easily that 3 is common in both terms. And I have c to the 4th here, c here, so c is in both terms. The smallest exponent is 1. D is in both terms. The smallest exponent is 1 as well. So I have 3CD common to both of these terms. Then I say 3CD times what value will give me 24C to the 4th D? So 3 times 8, which is a perfect cube, and C times C to the third power, which is a perfect cube. D times 1, which is a perfect cube, would give me just D. Then to that, I'm going to add, we said 125 times 3. C times 1 is C. D times D to the third power is my second monomial. Now, two monomials added together, they both have a perfect cube. Cube root of 8 is 2. Cube root of C cubed is C. Cube root of 125 is 5. Cube root of D cubed is just D. So we still have this 3CD term here. Don't forget that. Then we're going to multiply it by the cube root of this plus the cube root of this. As our first binomial, then we'll have a trinomial here, which is this term squared. Multiply these together, subtract that. So 2 times 5 is 10. C times D is CD. And then plus the last term squared is plus 25D to the third power. Hopefully you guys can see that. I'll write it clearer here. 3CD times 2C plus 5D. Close parentheses, begin parentheses. 4C squared minus 10CD plus 25D. Pause if you need to figure that out. I just rewrote this a little cleaner here, second time. The difference of cubes is the next thing we're going to cover. So the difference of cubes means this first term is a perfect cube, the second term is a perfect cube, but this time instead of adding, we're subtracting. We have a rule that works for this as well. A cubed minus B cubed is going to be, if I had room, I would write it right here, so you guys hopefully have room. I'll write real small, maybe I can fit it in. A cubed minus B cubed is equal to the cube of the first term, cube root of the first term, minus the cube root of the second term, times, notice this one's minus, where our last formula was plus there. So this matches whether it's the difference or the sum of cubes. But where it changes is here, we would have a squared plus ab plus b squared. Okay? A little clearer. One more time, if you didn't get that, a minus b times a squared plus ab plus b squared. Do I have a cube root of both of these terms? I do. It's going to be x and 1. The first one says minus here on the sign. The next one, I take the first term squared, multiply the two together, add that, square the last term, and add that. One squared is just one. Pretty quick factor. This one looks like you would take out a greatest common factor, but if you think about it for just a second, you'll see both 216 and 125 are on our list of perfect cubes, so we don't need to do that. We're going to take the cube root of the first term, which is 6 and k, and the cube root of the second term is just 5, times the 6k squared is 36k squared. Multiply the two together. 5 times 6 is 30. Oops, that should say 30k. And the last term here is going to be the 5 squared. Notice in the formula, this one had a minus sign here. This one has a plus sign here. And the last term on both is plus b squared. Okay? So the first operation here, if this is sum, this is going to be plus. If this is minus, this is going to be minus. The last term is the same in both. This one is the opposite. This is a plus b, this is minus. This is a minus b, then this is plus. The next one, there is a greatest common factor of 4. 4 times 1 minus 8h to the third. Now both of these terms are perfect cubes. I have 4 times 1 minus 2h is the cube root of 8h to the third. Then this term squared is just 1. Multiply them together is just 2h. And square 2h is plus 4h squared. Any questions? We're just following a pattern. Following a pattern. Next, let's see here. 2 doesn't have a perfect cube, but maybe I can factor it out. I can. 2 goes into both 2 and 54. That leaves me with a perfect cube of x cubed. 2 into 54 is 27. That is a perfect cube. Y cubed is a perfect cube. So, my first value here is the cube root of this. Of course, we keep our 2. Cube root of x cubed is x. Cube root of 27y cubed is going to be 3y. Then we multiply that by the trinomial of this term squared. Multiply the two together. And add 3xy. Then square the last term. 9y squared. Doing okay, Matthew? Everybody? Next page, trinomials. There's no quick and easy trick for these, okay? No necessarily completely easy trick. We just go back to what we were thinking before. get one of these to be the sum or difference of squares, actually the difference of two squares. This one makes this one the difference of two squares. So that would become n plus 2 and n minus 2. This one actually will not factor any farther. Value here, w, greatest common factor, that would leave me with w squared plus w minus 20. Can you think of two factors of 20 that have a difference of positive 1? Very good. So if we did our Xbox here, this is negative 20 on top, positive 1 on the bottom. Like Matthew said, we could multiply 4 and 5 and get the 20. One of them is negative, one of them is positive. Because this is plus w, the bigger term, the 5, is going to have the positive sign. And we put a w in front of both of those. And we have w minus 4 times w. Take a look at the next one. It looks like they're all even, and they all have an a value. So see if you can factor that out and factor this one real quick. Hopefully you guys got it. Two a factors out. That leaves me with a squared plus 19a plus 34. So this one I can probably factor. 1 times 34 is 34, and 19 is my b value here. I came up with 2 times 17 gives me 19. I'm sorry, 2 times 17 gives me 34. 2 plus 17 gives me 19. So factors here, that's an a, so it's going to be a plus 17 and a plus. Make sure 2a times a times a does give us 2a cubed, and 2a times 17 times 2 gives us 38a. I'm sorry, it gives us 64a. Quick check. 18, x is common, so I have x times x to the fourth minus 24x squared minus 25. Think about this one. Break that down and say the square root of x to the fourth is x squared. Square root of 25 is 5. Actually, that won't be a great way to do it. The difference of factors of 25 that add up to negative 24, it's going to be x squared minus 25, and x squared plus 1. That will give me minus 25x squared if I do the inner, and plus 1x squared for outer, which will give me a sum of 24x squared. This is the difference of two squares again. So x times x plus 5, x minus 5. For this term, we don't have a formula for this one, so it just stays x squared plus 1. 19. Let's keep going. We're on a roll. It's a trinomial. Even though this is not a squared term, our process still kind of works. We can say 3 times 5 would give us negative 15. And 14 for our b value. So factors of negative 15 that add up to 14 are going to be positive 15. We're going to divide both sides by 3. Okay. So if you're thinking of it that way, we have our simplifies to 5. We can't simplify that more. 1 over 3 So, just had a senior moment there. This doesn't simplify, so I'm going to put that 3 in front, like so. And that's as far as I can go with that. The answer key on this particular problem is wrong, so don't let that bother you. That's as far as I can factor it. Okay. Thoughts here. We're going to. This is a perfect square. This is a perfect square. The difference. I go 4 times 9 is 36, negative 12. So factors of 36 that add up to negative 12 are going to be minus 18 and plus 2. Because the middle term is a middle term here. This is 3m squared. And 3m squared. So if I just multiply those both times, the square root of 4, which is 2, then I get the correct term. So both of these are minus 3m squared times 3m squared is 9m to the fourth. Negative 2 times negative 2 is positive 4. 3m squared times negative 2 and 3m squared times negative 2 gives me negative 12. 6 minus 6, negative 6 minus 6 is negative 12m squared. Okay. So, will that factor any farther? No, this is not a perfect square. We could have the difference if both of those were perfect squares, but neither one is. So, I think I have to stop there. Let's see, 45 minutes, I think, is a pretty good lesson. Look back over what we've covered for a few minutes and make sure you've digested it. You can look for some examples and try to factor those. Just so it's clear here, these are the two. And see if you're ready for little tougher choices on those. Tomorrow we're going to cover four terms, and we're going to create a little help guide and do some practice problems. So have a good evening. No homework assignment today. You should post a copy of your notes for me, and I'll count that as your daily work. So it should look something like this, page and a half. And have a good evening.